हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम बैक ऑल ऑफ यू। इन टुडे सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू हैव डिस्कशन ऑन पीजोइलेक्ट्रिक सेंसर्स एंड एज अ नेम सजेस्ट द पीजोइलेक्ट्रिक सेंसर्स वर्क्स ऑन द प्रिंसिपल ऑफ पीजोइलेक्ट्रिक इफेक्ट एंड द पीजोइलेक्ट्रिक कम्स इन विच टाइप ऑफ मटेरियल दैट वी हैव टू नो फर्स्ट। सो द क्रिस्टल विच वी आर गोइंग टू गिव द पीजोइलेक्ट्रिक इफेक्ट्स आर named as piezoelectric crystal, and the example I have taken as silica 3SiO2. So I have drawn a three dimensional structure of one particular piece of the crystal. So the crystal is going to have pieces like this, multiple number of pieces. So we cannot actually guarantee that how many number of pieces are going to be inside the crystal. So that is going to depend on the geometry and all. So that's our not concern. Our concern is we are going to understand what exactly going to happen inside the crystal. So this crystal is having three molecules of SiO2. So this is having six faces. So three faces going to have Si plus, and also three places it is going to have O2 minus. So this is kind of hexagonal structure of our crystal. And if we are applying a dynamic force on it, like this is the crystal piece, and if we are applying force from top and bottom, or we are trying to vibrate it, so it is going to feel the dynamic force. So due to the dynamic force, the opposite faces of the crystal on which we are sensing the vibration going to generate different polarity of the charges at the opposite faces. So let us say the bottom face is going to generate the charge as plus, and the top face is going to accumulate the charges as negative charges. And if we can accumulate these charges on the metal plate, so we are going to form a capacitor there. And also, as I mentioned earlier, in the case of capacitance, we talk about the relative permittivity. So the relative permittivity of the medium is taken as ER, because the crystal is going to have material inside it. It is not going to be pure air, so it is going to have some relative permittivity of the medium. And if we are able to measure the charges accumulated with the help of capacitance, we are going to get the output voltage as E0. So that's the conclusion is, if we are applying dynamic force on a crystal, it is going to accumulate charge on its opposite faces. And due to the metal we are going to give to the crystal, we are able to form a capacitance Cp. So that particular capacitance, with the help of charges, going to provide us the output voltage with the relation as Q equal to Cv. So Q equal to C, I have taken the value as Cp. Cp means piezoelectric, and output I am taking as E0. So if we wish to write the expression for output voltage using Q equal to Cb, so it will become as Q equal to Cp into E0. So E0 will come out as Q by Cp. So the overall conclusion is, when the piezoelectric crystal is under dynamic stress — I am focusing again and again on the dynamic stress, because the piezoelectric crystal does not work on the static stress. So when the piezoelectric crystal is under dynamic stress, then due to internal molecular displacement, a charge Q deposited on the opposite surfaces of the crystal. So as I mentioned, if we are applying the force on the crystal, the opposite faces are going to accumulate the charges on it. And due to that, by accumulating this charge on two metal plates, it forms the capacitance. And we are if we are able to generate a capacitance, that particular charge will get accumulated on the opposite faces of it, and the capacitance is going to give the output voltage. So it is going to be an active process of conversion, where stress is getting converted into the voltage, and it is reversible also. That will come later. It is going to be reverse piezoelectric effect as well. So as of now, our focus is piezoelectric effect. So we have understood the concept of it, and now we'll try to write few formulas related to this, and then we'll proceed further with the electric equivalent circuit of the piezoelectric sensor. Having understood the piezoelectric concept, let us have the understanding of few basic standard formulas which we are going to make use of in the numerical solving process. So it is an active process where we are applying dynamic force, and we are getting the output as E0 volts. So the first formula is given as charge sensitivity, and charge sensitivity is given as charge developed divided by force applied, because if we are applying the force, we are getting the charge developed at the opposite faces of the crystal. So it is named as D and given as Q by F dynamic. So we are going to get one formula as Q equal to D into F. And the second standard formula is voltage sensitivity, and it is given as electric field intensity divided by applied stress. So why the electric field is coming in the picture? Because at the opposite faces there are plus and minus charges getting accumulated, and always there exists an electric field from positive charge to negative charge, and the thickness of crystal is given as T. So the electric field intensity is given as a voltage difference between those plates divided by the thickness of the plate, or the distance between the plates of capacitor. So it is given as E naught by T, the electric field intensity. And the applied stress is given as force per unit area. So we are getting the output formula Q G is equal to E naught by T into F by A. But actually we are not going to make use of it. Instead we are going to make use of G equal to D by epsilon naught and epsilon R. But how we are getting it, let us have look. So Cp, the capacitance of the piezoelectric sensor, is written as epsilon naught epsilon R A by T, because epsilon R is the permittivity of the medium. And making use of this expression number 1 and expression number 2, we will try to derive the voltage sensitivity formula. So G is equal to, the output E naught is equal to Q by C, because Q is equal to C into V. So E naught is equal to Q is DF divided by C is equals to epsilon naught epsilon R A by T. So this will come as E naught is equal to DFT divided by epsilon naught epsilon R into A. So the electric field intensity is E naught by T. So we will take T this side. So it will become as DF divided by epsilon naught epsilon R and A. So E naught by T divided by force per unit area. So this I will divide as force per unit area. So this whole expression will divide by force per unit area. So force per unit area get cancelled, and it come as D by epsilon naught epsilon R. So the voltage sensitivity is going to come as G equal to D by epsilon naught epsilon R. And the third case, we wish to know about the displacement sensitivity. What is actually happening if we are giving the dynamic stress on the crystal? It is going to feel the compression on it. So due to that, if the initial thickness of the crystal was T, so it will decrease by x, and it will become the final thickness as T minus x. So delta T, the change in thickness, final thickness minus initial thickness, is given as x. And using Hooke's law, we are able to write Young's modulus is equal to force per unit area divided by delta T by T, stress by strain. So from here we have the formula for force as YA by T into X, and comparing it with the F equal to KX, we are able to get the proportionality for stiffness constant K as YA by T. Sometimes it might be asked in the question that stiffness constant of the piezoelectric sensor. So in that particular case, we may have to use this particular formula. So the displacement sensitivity is given as E naught by X, output voltage divided by displacement input, and this is going to come as G into Y. And to derive that also, we have to do few calculation again. So H is equal to E naught by X, and E naught we have derived as G force per unit area into T divided by X. So G into force by A divided by T, it will come as from here we will have to put the value of X. So X will become as FT divided by YA. So FT divided by YA. So FT by A will get cancelled, and it will come as G by G into Y, because Y will come in the numerator. So that's all. Displacement sensitivity is H equal to G by. So these are the three basic standard sensitivity formulas which we will have to use in the numerical problem solvings. And now we'll have the look of electrical equivalent of the piezoelectric sensor. And the electric equivalent circuit of piezoelectric crystal is given as Norton equivalent circuit. And in this also, we are going to consider two cases, without load and with load. So initially, I am assuming there is no load on the piezoelectric sensor. There is only a sensor. So if we are applying force on it, we are going to get the rate of change in the charges, because we are not going to provide the static force, as I mentioned earlier. That's why I was mainly focusing on dynamic force. So dynamic force means it is going to vary with respect to time. It is going to have some rate of change with respect to time. So because of that, there is going to be not the static charge. Instead, there is going to be rate of change in the charges produced at the output or at the crystal. So due to which we are going to have current as IP is equal to dq by dt. So that's the main reason why we are actually taking this particular sensor as a Norton equivalent sensor. So IP is given as current due to change of rate of change of charges, and it has resistance RP and capacitance is taken as CP. So when there is no load, the ideal time constant of the sensor can be given as tau p is equals to RP into CP. And just assuming RP as 10 to the power 8 and CP as 3.14 into 10 to the power minus 10, and if I am writing the approximate ideal time constant without any load, it is going to come out as approximately 30 milliseconds. And in the second case, I am involving one op amp and also giving the input to the CRO. So whatever the voltage output we are giving, we have to sense it, right? So we cannot do it directly just by seeing it. We will not be able to understand what is happening. So we have to make use of other instruments as well. So all the other instruments which we are going to include in the forward path going to give the some loading effect. So this cable is going to have resistance and capacitance which we are using to connect the piezo sensor with our operational amplifier, and operational amplifier also has its own resistance and capacitance, and then again CRO is going to have again resistance and capacitance. So and I have taken the rough values of resistance and capacitances of cable as well as operational amplifier as well as CROs. So if we are connecting this load in series with the piezo sensor, we are going to have the equivalent resistance as RP, RCA, parallel R operational amplifier, parallel CRO, because all the resistance are going to come in parallel. So we are going to have equivalent resistance. So all the resistances connected in the parallel, the equivalent resistance is going to be lesser than the original one. And also keep in mind, we are connecting the piezo sensor using cable, not using the lead wires, because the difference is if we are using lead wires, the resistance is going to come in series and the capacitance also is going to come in series, whereas in the case of cable, we are going to have the resistance and capacitances in the parallel. That's why I have represented them in the parallel configuration. So the equivalent capacitance, all the capacitance in the parallel gets added, and the equivalent capacitance is going to be the greater than the actual one. So the new equivalent time constant is going to be tau equivalent is equal to R equivalent and C equivalent. And if I am putting all these values of resistance and capacitance, I am going to get the output equivalent time constant of sensor with the load as 45 milliseconds. It's not necessary, you can take any value. Just for understanding purpose, I have taken some values, and the output is coming as 45 milliseconds. So as we can see, without any load, in the ideal condition, the time constant of sensor was 30 milliseconds. And in the another case, if we are adding the load to the system, we are going to get the higher time constant. Higher time constant means it is going to take more time to reach the 63.25% of final value. So the system is going to become slow, because if it is taking more time to reach to the to some value, so the system response is going to be slow. So that's the basic idea. If we are using the ideal sensor, it is going to have the lower time constant, and if we are having the load connected with it, the time constant will increase and the system will be performing little slowly. So having understood the electric equivalent, now we'll try to understand the frequency response of our sensor. So here is the Norton equivalent circuit of our piezo sensor, and which I have drawn with load condition, and we are going to see how actually we are going to get the response of this particular sensor. So I have taken the current as I, and there are two branches of R equivalent and C equivalent, where R equivalent is going to be parallel combinations of all the resistance we had discussed earlier, and C equivalent is going to be the series parallel combination, but they are going to get added. So that we have already done, so let's not write it again. So let's proceed further with the basic calculation. So current I is going to be I1 plus I2 using KCL, the summation of current at this particular point. So if the current coming is I and it's going in two branches, I1 and I2. So I is equal to I1 plus I2. And as I mentioned, the current is going to come due to rate of change of charges in the piezoelectric sensor, because we are applying the dynamic force. So we are going to get dq by dt. And the current in I1 using Ohm's law, V is equal to IR. So I is equal to voltage by resistance, and voltage is EL, resistance is R equivalent, plus I2 is equal to C equivalent has given, so C equivalent into DEL by DT. I is equals to C dB by DT. So the voltage difference across capacitor, if it has voltage as V, so I is equals to C into dB by DT. So DE by DT. So now let us simplify this. Take R equivalent this side. So R equivalent dQ by DT is equals to EL plus, and R equivalent equivalent DEL by DT. So writing it as again I am multiplying it as C equivalent. So R equivalent into C equivalent become tau equivalent, and here also it is tau equivalent, so it will come as tau equivalent divided by C equivalent DQ by DT is equals to EL plus tau equivalent DEL by, and using charge sensitivity formula, we have D is equals to Q by F. So we can put Q as D into F. So DQ by DT will try to put as D into DF by DT. So we'll put this at this place. So this will come as tau equivalent divided by C equivalent into T into DF by DT is equal to EL plus tau equivalent DEL by DT. And this D by C equivalent I am naming as another constant K, and this will come as tau equivalent DF by DT is equal to EL plus tau equivalent DEL by DT, where we'll take K is equals to D by C equivalent and tau is equal to R equivalent C equivalent. So this we have to keep in mind. So this is simply first order differential equation, and let us apply Laplace transform both the sides. So K tau equivalent F into F of S into S is equal to E L of S plus tau equivalent E L of S into S. So we'll take K into tau equivalent F of S into S is equal to EL of S, will take common, and this will 1 plus tau equivalent of tau equivalent into S. So we'll try to write output EL of S divided by input F of S. So EL of S divided by F of S, this F of S will come this side. So at the numerator it will be K tau equivalent S, and denominator 1 plus tau equivalent S. So this is something looking like as a high pass filter transfer function. As we have seen in the previous case LVDT also, the transfer function came like this only, K tau S by 1 plus tau S. So this is going to be the high pass filter. So from the analysis of frequency response in the case of load condition, we are getting the dynamic characteristics as high pass filter. So the conclusion is the piezoelectric sensor is going to respond at higher frequencies much better than that of lower frequencies. And analyzing further, let us try to put S is equal to J omega, and if we put omega equal to 0, the EL of S, EL of J omega divided by F of J omega is will be K into 0 divided by 1 plus 0, so this will be 0. And at omega equal to infinity, this magnitude I'll write. So the magnitude of transfer function will be K tau equivalent, first I'll divide by S, so 1 by S plus tau equivalent, and S I will put as j omega, and 1 by infinity this will be 0. So k tau by tau is equal to k, and k we have as d by c equivalent. So the magnitude of output is d by c equivalent, and c equivalent, as we know, is going to be cp plus c cable plus c op amp, whatever we have connected in parallel. So we can see, in the ideal case without load, we had the output of magnitude of output as d by c. So only capacitance of the piezoelectric sensor was the factor, but here in this case we are getting the output as d by c equivalent. So it is quite clear that if we are using the piezoelectric sensor with load condition, we are going to get the slow output response, and also the error is going to be present even at the higher frequencies, because if we have if we are putting omega equal to infinity, we are getting the output as d by c equivalent. So c equivalent has a comparatively higher value than that of c naught cp. So if denominator has higher value, the magnitude will be lesser than the actual value. So for that we have another thing to improve our the response. So for that we are going to discuss the charge amplifier. And now we will again try to analyze the frequency response using charge amplifier. And charge amplifier is nothing but a electrical circuit of inverting amplifier who has resistance and capacitance RF and CF in the parallel in its inverting mode. So writing the same expressions again, we'll end up with the final transfer function. So this time we are going to take the magnitude of current. So magnitude of current at this point is going to be I1 plus I2. In the previous case, without charge amplifier, the value of resistance and capacitance was R equivalent and C equivalent, and the current was going through them. But here, instead of allowing the current to pass through the equivalent parts, we are going to give the path to the current so that it doesn't fall in this particular branches. Instead, they go to the feedback parts of the operational amplifier. How it is going to happen? Because due to the property of operational amplifier, the virtual ground, if it is at 0 volt, the another terminal is also going to be at 0 volt. So the voltage difference across the resistance and capacitance is going to be 0 volt. So they are not going to draw any current in it. So we can just simply ignore them. So, but now if the total current coming here is I, because there is no current in these branches, and it is getting split it again into I1 and I2. So now again the same thing, I is equal to dq by dt, and I1 will be V0 by R using the Ohm's law, and I2 is going to be CF into dV0 by dt. And again the same derivation we have to do. I think that can be done by yourself also, so better to write the final transfer function itself so that we can save some time. So the final transfer function is going to come as V0 of S divided by F of S. In the previous case, instead of V0, we had the output as EL, and the input was force. So V0 by F of S will come K into tau equivalent of S divided by tau 1 plus tau equivalent of S. So in the previous case, we had K as D by C equivalent. So here in this case, so it is going to be same, and tau equivalent is equal to C equivalent into R equivalent. But in the previous case, value of C equivalent was CP plus C CRO plus C op amp, so and plus C cable. So all the things was included, but in this case the equivalent capacitance seen by the current is going to be only CF. So tau equivalent this time is going to become tau F, and the resistance is going to be seen as RF. So that's the going to be the main advantage. Instead of facing the equivalent resistances of the load, we are going to face the equivalent resistance of the feedback path. So due to which magnitude at omega equal to 0, S equal to j omega, so k into 0 divided by 1 plus 0 is k, and magnitude at omega equal to infinite is going to be, so first we'll divide by S, so k tau by 1 by S plus tau, 1 by infinity is 0, so k tau by tau is k, and k is d by c equivalent, and c equivalent in this case is CF. So now we'll try to compare all these three cases without load, with load, and with the charge amplifier. So now in the ideal case, we had the transfer function E naught of s divided by f of s equal to, the transfer function is anyway going to be the high pass filter k tau equivalent of s divided by 1 plus tau equivalent of s. But the values of k and tau s are going to be different in all these cases. So the value of k in the first case is d by c equivalent is cp, and in the second case with load it is going to be d by cp plus cl, all the load capacitances, and in the third case charge amplifier k is going to be d by cf, only the feedback capacitance is going to be taken into the consideration, and also the tau equivalent is equal to r equivalent into c equivalent. So here it is rp cp, here it is with load, so r equivalent c equivalent only will write, because r equivalent will be the parallel combinations of all and c equivalent will be cp plus cl, and in this case tau equivalent will be rf into cf. Actually we don't have anything to do with the time constant, just for understanding I am writing, we have to focus mainly on the k values. So the output magnitude at omega equal to 0 in all these three cases is going to be 0, because it is an high pass filter in all these three cases. So the profile will be like this. So at omega equal to 0 the magnitude is going to be 0 only, but at omega equal to infinity we are going to see some interesting thing in all these three different cases. So first I'll divide this particular transfer function by s, so this will become as k tau equivalent divided by 1 by s plus tau equivalent, and if I put omega equal to infinity, 1 by infinity will become 0, so this will come as k tau divided by tau, tau and tau get cancelled, so k. So the magnitude of output E naught divided by F, output divided by force, always going to come as K. So K means D by Cp, D by Cp plus Cl and D by Cf, and we'll try to write only output. So in first case E naught is equal to, E naught by F is equal to K. So E naught is equal to Kf, in the with load case El is equal to K into F again, because K value will be different. And in our final case V naught, because output is V naught, this will be K into F. So in this case K is D by Cp into F, in this case D by Cp plus Cl into F, and in this case D by Cf into F. So this is going to be the magnitude, and D into F we know that Q is equal to DF. This formula is from the charge sensitivity, so this we can write as D into F as Q. So Q by Cp, this will be Q by Cp plus Cl, and this will be Q by Cf. So we can compare now in all these three cases. In the first case the magnitude will be Q by Cp, Cp is the lowest value. In the second case with load condition the magnitude will be at omega equal to infinity Q by Cp plus Cl, so this Cp plus Cl is going to be the largest value in all these three of them. And in the third case the magnitude will be going to Q by Cf, so Cf value will be lesser than Cp, but greater than Cp, but it is going to be lesser than Cp plus Cl. So we are going to get three different responses. So in the first case Q by Cp, this was our true value, but in the second case with load condition we got Q by Cp plus Cl, so the response is getting decreased too much. So for that we have introduced charge amplifier, and in that case we are going to get the response as Q by Cf. So though it is still going to be the lesser than the actual output at omega equal to infinity, but it is improved compared to the load condition. So that's why we are making use of charge amplifier to improve our response than that of load condition. So this is the basic idea about the piezoelectric sensors, and that's all for today. If you have any doubt you can ask in the comment section.